नमस्कार, आई एम प्रोफेसर रमेश चंद्र गौड़, डीन एंड हेड कलानिधि डिवीजन, इंदिरा गांधी नेशनल सेंटर फॉर द आर्ट्स। एक्सटेंड ए वेरी हार्टी वेलकम टू ऑल ऑफ इन दिस सेलिब्रेशंस फॉर इंटरनेशनल आर्काइव्स वीक। वी आर हियर टू हैव वेबिनार ऑन डिजिटाइजेशन, डिजिटल प्रिजर्वेशन एंड एक्सेस ऑफ आर्काइवल मटीरियल इन इंडियन लाइब्रेरीज एंड आर्काइव्स। पर्टिकुलरली वी वुड लाइक टू शोकेस द इनिशिएटिव undertaken by Indira Gandhi National Center for the Arts, which is one of the very premier institution of Ministry of Culture. For this webinar, we have very dynamic team of IGNC to present the excellent work done by them during the digital initiative. Various kind of digital repository have been created and other projects have been taken for preservation and dissemination of Indian cultural heritage. And that is the basic purpose of celebrations of International Archives Week, to create an awareness about various resources and collections to the worldwide research community, and also to make use of technology in preservation and access to various kind of cultural heritage. So in this direction, today we have with us Professor Pija, who is the Director of Cultural Informatics Laboratory, a very important department of IGNCA, which is responsible for digitization, digital archiving, and digital creation of digital repository of various heritage acquired by IGNCA through various projects in Kalanidhi Reference Library, Kalanidhi Cultural Archive, Kalanidhi Slide Unit, Kalanidhi Manuscript unit. And apart from that, he is a very active and very busy and instrumental in many of the Ministry of Culture initiative in creation of various digital applications. And also internationally, he has been engaged in various international projects with International Council of Cultural Relations. He's the person who known in entire cultural heritage for use of technology and a number of multimedia and number of other digitization project. He is currently also heading as a director of National Mission for Manuscript, which is responsible for preservation of Indian ancient manuscripts. And under his able leadership, almost 4.3 million manuscripts have been cataloged, and still work is going on. So thank you, Professor Jha, and welcome you to the program, and look forward to your presentation. We have with us Dr. Sudhir Lal, a very known academics, and he's basically worked in Kalakos division, also headed Kalakos division. He's also instrumental in various new projects at IGNCA, and so one of the most important project on as a Vedic heritage portal, which is because Vedas are considered the most prominent resource in cultural heritage, and everybody wants to have access to the resources, and he is very doing a very hard work in creating a single window access to all Vedic heritage portal. Beside, he has been instrumental in various other projects of Kalakos division. So thank you, Dr. Sudhir Lal, and looking forward to your presentation. And another young and very dynamic leader we have in Dr. Achal Pandya, one of the most eminent conservation specialist in this country, very actively involved in various international bodies of conservation and preservation. He's also heading the Cultural Archive of Kalanidhi, and he's very innovative, and the most important aspect of his leadership in this area is that he has done a lot of own initiative in storage or in conservation. He always loved to do practicals and to implement. And then when we talk about Jugaad, he's expert in having Jugaad in storage and all those things, in putting things in such a right manner that you will love to see his experiments. And when we were shifting from our old location to new location, he was the first one to shift the entire archival material in the new building and start operating conservation lab and all those things. So welcome, Achal, and look forward to your presentation. Our member secretary, Dr. Sachidanand Joshi, who is going to chair this discussion, will join us soon. And as you know, under his dynamic leadership, last 4 or 5 years, IGNC has done tremendous work. So before all of them speak, let me just have some glimpses about the IGNCA, its work done. So let's just me share a small presentation. As we all know, India, Indira Gandhi National Center for the Arts was set up in 1987 as an autonomous trust under the Ministry of Culture, Government of India, for a basic purpose to promote the preservation and dissemination and cataloging, digitization, and access to cultural heritage. And it is being envisioned as a major resource center for arts, especially primary material, and also to undertake research and translation of manuscript, also to work on various tribal and folk arts, intangible cultural heritage, and tangible cultural heritage, provide a forum for creative and critical dialogue among the diverse art, and also to evolve as a model for research program and administration of arts, to promote awareness and sensitivity to the historical and cultural interlinkages and interactions between India and other parts of the world, particularly South and Southeast Asia, and also to facilitate and promote systematic scientific understanding, the formative and dynamic factors in the complex web of cultural interaction between diverse communities, and to make efforts to bridge the gap in the intellectual understanding between the modern sciences on the one hand and the arts, culture, traditional skills and knowledge of others, and also to develop the linkages with other national, international centers of culture, and to affiliate with the university and other academic organizations of higher learning within India or abroad for the conduct of research in art, humanities, and cultural heritage. To do that, our aim is to make the IGNCA as a center for cultural regeneration, to make center of socio-cultural dialogue and understanding, to make a center of knowledge and research for South Asian cultural heritage, to make it a center of learning for studies of cultural heritage of Indian diaspora, to make it a center of convergence for various art forms, traditions, heritage in and around country, to make it a people-friendly center where creation and intellect from every corner is equally respected, to make it a center where traditional meets modernity, where the classical meets the folk, where arts meet science, where ethos meet expression, and where tradition meets innovation. And in this context, we have been working to make IGNCA as Institute of National Importance, and we are all trying to have a world-class repository of art and culture, so Kalanidhi, and we have been trying to have various academic program to make it as an institute of excellence in higher education with 9 PG diploma courses and 5 certificate courses, and also to promote Indology study from Indian perspective, and to nurture Indian scholarship in the field of culture for various fellowships, and also to make a world-class center of manuscriptology and conservation for various kind of training program, internship, and also to develop a center and develop big archive for Indian cultural studies in physical as well as in digital format. In that context, IGNCA is having several divisions headed by, which is headed by executive head is member secretary, then Kalanidhi, a multi-form resource library, Kalakos devoted mainly to the study and publication, Janpa Sampada, Kala Darshan, Cultural Informatics, Sutrada, which is the administrative division, and also a conservation laboratory and media center. We also have 9 regional centers to help us in reaching out to the people in different culture, different languages, in the different parts of the country, in Varanasi, in Bangalore, in Guwahati, in Ranchi, in Thrissur, in Baroda, in Puducherry, in Goa, in Srinagar. So let's talk about first about Kalanidhi, which is basically a resource center. And in this resource center, we have different units, reference library, print library, databases, and all those things. Then we have reprography, which is responsible for microfilming of manuscript from inception of IGNCA, a visual library in form of slide unit, and then also we have cultural archive and other databases. Kalakosh, as I mentioned, which is While the Kalanidhi collects primary and secondary material, SIPS from an evolved databases, the Kalakos investigates the intellectual traditions in their dimensions of multi-layer and multidiscipline. As a research and publication division, it endeavors to place the arts within the integral framework of cultural system, combining the textual with the oral, the visual with oral, and the theory with practice. More, Dr. Sudhir Lal will explain to you in detail about that. We have another important division, Janpasampada division, which is basically do the study on various kind of programs, intangible cultural heritage. And it aims at understanding the arts in their eco-cultural and socio-economic context. Its emphasis is on the oral tradition that orients the literature tradition in reality. Here, theory and practice, textual and oral, verbal, visual, and kinetic are seen as semantic whole, not as items to be aggregated. And as I mentioned, Cultural Informatics Laboratory is engaged in interactive multimedia documentation and in-depth analysis of cultural information, and also various digitization and digital archiving project on digital heritage. Kaladarshan, which is a window to disseminate information through exhibitions, seminars, and various kind of other programs. And also we have various kind of activities in this context. Also we have Adi Drash department, rock art division, which takes care of various kind of inscription and all form of rock arts. Media center is a research publication to bring out various kind of research publication. And then we have various kind of other projects focusing on reviving the links with the nations of Indian Ocean. This is a project Mausam, which is basically responsible for, with the help of Ministry of Culture, this project has been taken, reviving links with nations in the Indian Ocean region, achieving UNESCO transnational nominations under World Heritage, creating comprehensive database and promote research in maritime cultural landscape and routes, basically to focus on maritime heritage. And the media center is responsible for documentation and also various kind of helping various division in organization of the programs and other things in video recording, audio recording. GNCA implements its mandate by various activities, bringing out research and publication, acquisition of various kind of material, including rare material, also various kind of program, women's studies, and various kind of other cultural studies, various new projects, which is Bharat Vidya Pariyojana, Nari Sambhav Pariyojana, Sanskrit Sambhav Sankala, conferences, exhibitions, seminars, webinars, and we have various kind of publications series. I think Sudhir will tell you more about that. Also, IGNCA is trying to bring out various catalogs, both descriptive and online catalog, interactive media, and all those things. The unique program in terms of resources, apart from 2 lakh books and 2.5 lakh manuscripts and over lakhs of slides, IGNCA is having a unique program of acquiring the personal collection of eminent scholar, both in print and archival form. And in this context, we have 24 personal libraries of eminent scholars from different aspects, different part of for the country. An important name, Hazari Prasad Dwivedi, Namber Singh, Shyam Benegal, we have Dr. Kapila Vashyan, we have Mohan Khokar Dance Collection. And to promote publications on art and culture, IGNCA's book circle program by the Kalanidhi Reference Library is also a very important and regular program through which we reach out to the people and connect between author and a publication. And now we are doing it virtually also. And this cultural archive, where my colleague Dr. Achal will be talking more about that, is also having more than 45 unique personal collection, such as Raja Deen Dayal collection of photographs, and Elizabeth Bruner painting collection, A.K. Kumaraswamy collection, and so on. So we have this manuscript microfilm program, which started in 89 and continued till the National Mission for Manuscript came into being. And till that, 52 manuscript libraries were microfilmed and now all digitized. So about 300,000 manuscripts are available. And our research scholars work on these manuscripts to bring out various kinds of translations and also a descriptive catalog of manuscript. Yesterday, we have launched 5 e-volumes of manuscript catalog. IGNC as a nodal center, and I myself as a member of International Advisory Committee of UNESCO Memory of the World Program, I have been responsible for this UNESCO Memory of the World Program, which is responsible, which has three type of register: international register, regional register, and national register. So IGNC is also coordinating for that. And as a dean academics, I am responsible, along with our under the dynamic leadership of our member secretary, to conduct these program. And we have excellent faculty member, like many of the program director, like Professor Jhaap and Dr. Achal Pandey, are here in this program today. So these 9 PG diploma courses and 5 certificate courses are being conducted by IGNC to develop manpower in the field of art and culture. So these are the few glimpses of IGNCA programs and activities. And now you will know more about our specific projects and programs through our eminent officers. They will explain you, or faculty will talk about more about specific program. So in this direction, let me first invite Professor Pija to start his presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Gaur, for giving the brief of the institution. Today I'm going to present only about one of the initiatives, that's National Cultural Audiovisual Archives initiative, and then the project was approved by the Ministry of Culture and interested IGNCA to develop a digital archives for the preservation, with the aim to preserve the audiovisual heritage of the country created during the last century. And we know that all these data in the audiovisual form have been created into the analog formats. So idea was to digitize these collections and make it accessible to the public. Many of these collections enshrines the rare creativity of the artists of that time. And initially, it was decided that we'll go ahead with the pilot phase of the project. And once the successful implementation of the pilot phase, we'll go for the to take up the large scale project on the same subject. We initiated this project in 2014, and we have been successfully implemented this project. The pilot phase is completed in this March, and we have submitted the proposal for the next phase of the project. This is the unique project in the sense that such type of projects were not on the digital archiving was not taken up in India that way. So I'll start with the initial aim of the project, and I'll say that archiving in general, what it is. So if any memory institutions, if you talk about the archives or the museums, basically three major activities: one is the acquisition, another one is the organization of the resources which they acquire, and thirdly is the dissemination of the resources. And this dissemination is not only for the present generation but also for the future generations. So long-term preservation is one of the major aspects of the institutions or the memory institutions or the archives involved. When any institutions acquire these collections, they have to make a detailed cataloging, as all of you know. And when you talk of the cataloging, this includes the administrative metadata of the subject or administrative details of the acquisition, as well as the content or the thematic resources, which integrates the context of the subject or object in itself. And thirdly, it is the copyright related aspects. When we talk of the, and based on our experience, we can say that most of the audiovisual collections which we have acquired does not have the much details to make the complete database or precise metadata. So at many of the times, what we have done, we have initiated with the basic or the administrative metadata, gone for the digitization of the content, and after the digitization of content, enriched the metadata, at least in the thematic part or the context part of the subject. So that was the scenario. In addition, that most of the institutions does not maintain the copyright information. And earlier, the copyright informations were never documented. Now, for making the purpose of the dissemination, now it has been felt that it is now required to have the IPR audit of every collection, every object, and every collections. So, on the basis of that, we have involved some of the experts for creating the IPR advisory, so that some of the information can be inferred from the sources of the collection. Like if an institution has funded for the creation of an audiovisual record, so in that case, the institutions who has funded for the acquisition of the archives will have the copyright, and accordingly we have categorized the different aspects of the source of the content generation, and accordingly devised a system for allocating the copyright information with each of these records. And although it's just an estimation, we cannot say that this always meets the Copyright Acts of the Government of India, but yes, in most of the cases, it will abide by them. And hopefully we'll be able to use the same pattern for the other cultural resources wherever the copyright issues are not maintained properly. Second aspect which comes with the archiving is the organization of the material, storage management. In case of the analog material, we know the proper storage of different types of material for each cases, the storage conditions, the packing material, and all these things needs to be kept before making it stored properly for the long term. Secondly, when you talk about the storage management, we also have to see that the deterioration of the analog material is very, very slow compared to the digital material. So if we keep the analog materials intact, the life of the analog material goes much beyond, only except in the cases where the playing equipment, in case of audiovisual material, where the playing equipment is not there, the data cannot be retrieved. So it is necessary that in such cases, the data must be digitized immediately without any delay, so that the content associated with these records can be preserved. And third is the dissemination. As discussed, the copyright and the IPR is the very, very important right. We cannot bypass the copyright law and the IPR Act of the Government of India, the IT Act of the Government of India, and the Storage Management Act of the Government of India. So based on that, whatever the information, Right of Information Act. So keeping all these information in mind, we institutions need to plan a dissemination mechanism or policy for the institutions to make their collections accessible. When it comes to the digital archiving, the activities associated with the analog archives and the digital archives does not change. So even for the digital archiving, the content creation, the storage of the content or the storage of the digital data, and the dissemination of content is the same major activity. But the digital data comes with many challenges. And before going for the digital archiving, it is necessary to understand the challenges which is there before the digital data. When we are creating the content in the metadata itself, we need to store the information related to the digital data, the file format, the bit rates on which the digitized data has been stored, the location of the digitized data. All these information needs to come with the metadata itself. In addition, we also have to ensure that the metadata, when we are creating, it must be in the open database format, and also the digital files must be in the open file, so that in future data is not locked. So we are converting a data from a log format and bringing it into the digital format, but here we have to ensure that data is not getting logged, and for that we need to go for the open standards or open archiving standards accepted internationally, called OAIS model. So in that model, as per the prescriptions of that model, one needs to preserve the data. In addition to that, when we are talking of the digital data, the digital file and the metadata are the two separate things. So how to integrate these while storing the data, and then we create a digital object And this digital object not only contains the digital file, but also the metadata of that file associated with that particular object. So while storing the data, we are storing the digital object, and this digital object not only contains the digital file, but also the metadata associated with file, so that in any case of if any of the digital object is misplaced, we will be able to locate the actual position of that particular location and put it back. Then comes is the major issues which is with the digital data, that the data life of the digital data is very, very minimal. The files is changing very fast with the change in the technology. The format, file format changes. The media in which the data is stored, that's also changes. So one needs to plan for the media change, media migration, as well as the file or the format migration periodically. Similarly, the chance of data loss in case of the digital data is very high, and therefore one needs to keep a backup system in place. Sometimes in case of the online backup system, we mirrored the files, mirrored the servers, but in that case, if data is lost in one drive, the mirrored drive also will lose the data, and therefore we need to keep at least one copy offline also to preserve the data. So multiple copies of the data is proposed for the backup management of the data, but also when we keep the multiple backup copies, the migration also required to be upgraded every time for all the backup copies. So there is need to devise the optimum backup systems in which we can ensure that there is no data loss for future, and data is saved at least in one of the formats or one of the places. Then is the storage environment where we are storing this data. And that is very, very important, that generally when we store the data, the live data requires, even the offline data requires a controlled environment, controlled temperature, controlled humidity, which generally in many cases we cannot be able to afford. So it is necessary that we need to have the controlled environment storages at least in two seismic zones to preserve the data for the long term. Secondly, for the data security and the rights management. So every individual who are associated with the development of these archives will be given some rights to access rights to preserve the information. And in that also, we have to ensure that at any particular point, there is not a single point of failure. So while assigning the rights, one has to ensure that there is not a single point of failure, and these security checks and the what's called the password management has to be keep on rolling, so that at any particular moment of time, the one person cannot be in position to delete or damage the data. In addition to that, the digital data also faces the external factors like the platform on which we store the data, the cyber security, cyber threats which is there on the data, and the platform dependencies, because the software companies, the hardware companies, they always migrate their information, and it is necessary that the system or the digital archive also update themselves. But all these things require a lot of money, and hence the institutional mechanism to have the team to have the continuous flow of fund is very, very required for any storage or of the digital data, or for any archiving, digital archiving. And then finally, it is the dissemination. So when you are talking of the dissemination, we need to have a access policy based on the IT Act, Right of Information Act of the country. And in case we find at any particular moment of time, there is some class of the copyright and other issues, we must have a takedown policy so that we can withdraw that information from the live media. And then the personalization. So every individual today, they need the data in their way, in their format, and as and when they need. So personalization of the data, that has to be integrated at some place of time, so that the user will feel that this data is for them, for their use, and as and when they need, they can access it. So these are the few issues which is related to the digital archiving. It's a TDR, trusted digital repository systems and this standards for ISO standards for the trustworthy digital repository, that is ISO 16363, was developed, formulated in 2012. And the issues or the known threats on a digital archive has already been discussed in detail, and based on that, a standard have been formulated, although we can say that this is only about the known threats. In future, when the new threats comes, we need to revise the standards, and accordingly, the archiving standards also has to be modified, and each of the archives has to model themselves to take up the new challenges. I'm happy to inform you that the NCAA is world's first ISO certified trustworthy digital repository, and we hope that many more trustworthy digital repositories will come up in India and other parts of the world. As on date, only two trusted ISO certified trusted repositories are there. One is the GovInfo project of the US government's publication office and NCAA. So only two is there, but hope in the future many more trustworthy digital repositories will come up. Now, coming to the project of NCAA, the project has been initiated by the Ministry of Culture with the aim to preserve the cultural heritage available in the audiovisual resources. So the idea was to identify the selected resources in the institutes, partnering institutions, and go for the rare and non-commercial informations for the digitization and make it accessible into the public domain. So with that objectives, this project was initiated by the Ministry of Culture, and the initial target of the project was 31,000 hours to be published during the pilot phase of the project. We have formulated the digitization and the metadata standards in the Dublin Code. Metadata standards is there, and all these standards is available into the NCAA web portal. And any of the institutions who are interested in creating their metadata and the digitization, they can access these standards and use that from our portal. And then the capacity building was another thing that took in the digital archiving. Only few institutions are working at this moment. So the capacity is also lacking in this area. And we have done some of the remarkable work in this area also, training the people. Now these portals which have been made live, the partnering institutions. So we have the 30 partnering institutions across the country, and these are the lists. If you see it from the Uttar Pradesh, we have four basically, not three, four. From the Rajasthan, we have one. Gujarat, it is two. Maharashtra, it is three. Kerala. So during the pilot phase of the project, we have tried to capture most of the part of the India. So that when the main projects or the larger project will come up, we will have an easy to reach to that particular region, as at least one of the institutions are already working with us. So keeping that in mind, these are the 30 institutions covering every region of the India. The partnering and the collaborative institutions, we have 30 institutions. This includes archives. That is the National Archives, national institutions like IGNCA, IGRMS, CCRT. So all the national level institutions of the Ministry of Culture or even the Ministry of External Affairs and the other institutions in some of the universities too. Then it is the broadcast archives, production broadcast archives like Cinema Vision India. They are the partners. The Maulana Azadi Urdu University, they are the partners, although we have not done some of the limited work with that institution, but in the coming phase, we will be able to do it. And then there are many research institutions like Rupayan Sanskhan, Jodhpur, Sambhad Foundation, Natya Shodh, Sangeet Parishad, Kasi, Saptak Archives, Sri Kasi Sangeet Samaj, and these are the institutions all across the India. And they are the partner in the pilot phase of the project. Now, the key implementation aspect of the NCAA, if you talk up, we have taken the three major criteria, which I thought that to share with you, is the content selection guideline. So we have tried that the content, which is on the format where the players are not easily available or the condition of the that the physical format is not very good, we should go ahead with that. And then the content, if the rare content, we'll go for the, so we have made a content selection guidelines for the partnering institutions so that they can select the content for the pilot phase of the project. Then is the digitization and the metadata standards, as already communicated to you, that we have taken the ISA standards for the digitization and Dublin Core schema for the extended Dublin Core for the metadata standards. And then we have created some of the standard operating systems so that the communication between the project management unit of the project as well as the partnering institutions, they synchronize the activities of each other while sending the files for the digitization integrating the data into the portal. So these are the few implementation aspects we have covered. Out of the 30,000 hours which we have thought of, we will do it, 31,500 hours of the data have been digitized and made it accessible on this portal. 65 lakh hits we have got it for this project since August 2017, since we have started this project. And this is the visitors on the NCA web portal, if you see, and the highest is from the India, that is 27%. And then coming to the USA, it is 20%. And this is again, the distribution shows that the data is accessed from all over the world. So this is some of the... Now, during this implementation of this project, we have made many policy documents because once we have decided that we will go for the ISO certification of this project, then it was mandatory also. And some of them, we thought that generally when we do the projects, we generally lack in the documentation. So we thought to make the policy documents, whether it's related to the stories, whether it is related to the designated community who is a part of the development, as well as the user group. So how they feel, how they will be involved in the whole development process, then the traceability metrics in case of any disaster, whether it's the natural or the cyber attack, where we should reach. So who will be the responsible and what is the traceability metrics that we have developed. Then the digital preservation aspects, what you have taken, disaster recovery policy in case of the online data is lost, how we can retrieve it from the backup data or the offline data, and then the access policy. So these are the few policy documents which we have created, and it's all available into the public domain in our portal, and the many institutions are using this for their digital archiving purposes. And this is the certificate that we have been the world's first ISO certified trusted digital repository, and PTAB, Primary Trustworthy Authorization Body of the UK, that has been audited our archives 3 times, and then finally 2017 we received this award. And this award is only for 3 years. After that we need again to renew that because the standards which has been used at that time has to be reviewed, and based on that we have to prove that even with the revised standards, our archives meet all the requirements of the archiving, and we are in process of getting it updated certification. So based on our experience, we have also used it for our PG Diploma in Cultural Informatics course, an elective called the audiovisual archiving, where the different aspects of the audiovisual archiving which we teach to the students, and for the 2 batches of the PG Diploma course, some of the students elected this subject, and they have got benefited with our course material. Next is the Sangam Music App. So we discussed that for any archive, the personalization of the content is very much required. So from these archives, we have created a devotional music, and that again, with the initiative of the Ministry of Culture, that when they were going for the Kumbh at Sangam, Allahabad, at that time we thought that we'll give the name of this music app as a Sangam Music. Here it is the combination of the different target groups, so that we had tried. And this music app is available into the Play Store, so anybody can download it. Although it's at this moment containing around 3,000 tracks, but in the future, hopefully, we'll be able to add many more tracks on the basis of these archives. Now, in this, we have also featured some of the playlists associated with the different faiths, religion of the people. But in addition to that, we have also given the user option to play, create their own playlist, so user can access it. These tracks can be played, and many of the as per the different timings of the particular song, like Prahar. So one can play as the Prahar, one can play as the artist. So there are the different formats and access mechanism which you have provided. You go through it, and what are the inputs will be there, you share with us, so that we will be able to make it more accessible, more user friendly. So, and these are the few curations on the Sangam. It's on the occasion of the different themes, if you see. And these are the comparison between the different music apps which is available. So how we are comparable to them. So that we have tried to reflect it here. I'll just show you some of the glimpses from the NCA repository. So this is the NCA homepage. This is the video from National Archives of India. And it is the immersion of Gandhiji's ashes in Jabalpur. It's a silent film of 10 minutes or so. I'll take you to some other one. This is Pandit Ravi Shankar.
Somehow I ended up with
keep that. Bye.
Rare recording where he is teaching his daughter. I'll also show you one more, so of A.R. Rahman.
Thank you. So he died when he was nine years old. So I had to come into music for family. So at the age of 11, I came to, began playing as a session musician, film music. Then I switched to ads at, I was at 89, and this home studio was built at the time. Slowly it was into this, commercials, ads, documentaries and all
this. So some of the rare recordings we could be able to acquire through this portal, I will just show you some of the audio.
Tagore's universalist concept of education, Tagore, the all-pervasive excellence of a many splendid genius, and Tagore in translation.
This is from the seminar conducted by the Sahitya Academy.
Our main purpose is to evaluate Tagore again after a gap of 25 years to find out how far is irrelevant even today in the last phase of the 20th century. I may only say, if human life gains the greatest part of its richness and meaning,
for each of these recordings, if you see with the metadata, which is divided into the administrative, descriptive, and technical, we have also put two files. One is the physical condition assessment report of that particular tape or the analog body, and the digitization quality check report with each of these recording. So if you click on any of these, we'll have these informations so that in the future, if someone will try to check it, that why the data is not, or the digital data is not complete. So we'll be able to know that even at the time of the digitization itself, the analog content itself did not have that particular part of the data. So these are the few initiatives from our side. So with that, I'd like to thank all of you. Thank you, Dr. Goel.
Thank you, Professor Jha, for a very informative and wonderful presentation. And I'm sure people will make use of this repository, because this repository contains so many rare footage, which generally it is very difficult to find in various repository. So thank you very much for your wonderful presentation. So now I would like to invite our next speaker, Dr. Sudhir Lal. Sudhir, now it's over to you.
Namaskaram and greetings to everyone. It is indeed my honor to present the Vedic Heritage Portal in front of all of you as a part of the International Archives Week celebrations in the webinar on digitization, digital preservation, and access of archival material in Indian libraries and archives initiatives of Ministry of Culture, Government of India. I thank the Chair, Professor Dr. Satchidanand Joshi, Member Secretary of IGNCA, and Professor Ramesh Gaur, Dean Academics and Head of Kalanidhi of IGNCA, for having me here today, along with Professor Pratapanand Jha and Dr. Achal Pandya. Professor Gaur, in his opening remarks, has very significantly underlined the theme of today's webinar. And Professor Jha has lucidly put the challenges and perspectives required for the dialogue. This has made my job comparatively easy. So let me just run you through this presentation. The IGNCA Vedic Heritage Portal is a flagship program of Ministry of Culture, Government of India. And the logo or the motto of the portal has been Ano Bhadraha Kratavo Yantu Vishwataha. That is, let noble thoughts come to us from all directions. So let me quickly run you through this. With the passage of time, a gap has been generated between two streams of knowledge, the traditional and the modern. This is mainly because the current education system could not relate itself to the traditional Indian knowledge systems. So there have been few attempts till date to investigate the Vedic knowledge systems through the scientific tools that are available to us today. So taking cognizance of this necessity to bridge the gap, the Ministry of Culture, Government of India, accorded sanction for instituting a project titled the Vedic Heritage Portal at the IGNCA New Delhi. The pilot phase of the project has been successfully completed, and much of the curated data has been made available online. The vision of the Vedic Heritage Portal is to create a digital platform through the IGNCA as a one-stop solution for any user regarding Vedic heritage, who would like to search any information regarding Vedic heritage, be it abstract oral traditions or the more in tangible textual information, including the linkages of the Vedic traditions with the present context and academic disciplines. Such an integrated platform is a first of its kind in the domain of Vedic traditions and is of tremendous importance to a wide range of users who will ultimately be able to see a Vedic map of India. And the mission statement is that the Vedas, as we all know, are the source of integral wisdom, science, tradition, and culture of a remarkable civilization and are the fountainhead of its knowledge systems. It is the mission of the Vedic portal to identify and compile varied Vedic traditions in oral, textual, and audiovisual forms, along with their textual and verbal interpretations, and to curate this material in such a way that it reflects consonance with the modern education system while stressing on its continued relevance. So I think it is nice that we know what we are dealing with. So this is a brief corpus of the Vedic traditions. As you all know, there are four Vedas: Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, Sam Veda, and Atharva Veda. And these are constituents of different four different classes of literary works, which are Samhitas, Brahmanas, Aranyakas, and Upanishads. And then there are ancillary texts like the Vedangas, the limbs of the Veda, so to say, which help us understand the Veda. These are Shiksha, Kalpa, Vyakaran, Nirukta, Chandas, and Jyotish. And each of the Vedas are progenitors of Upavedas, understood as various branches of knowledge. For example, the Rig Veda has the Ayurveda as its Upaveda, the Yajur Veda has Dhanurveda, Sama Veda has Gandharva Veda, and Atharva Veda has Arthashastra. The entire corpus serves as the bedrock of Indian knowledge traditions, which in the course of time manifested with great vigor and vitality to nourish our intellect for generations. The aims and the objectives of the portal are to present an introduction to the Vedas, Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, Sam Veda, and Atharva Veda, with their structure for easy understanding to the common people, to relate Vedic wisdom with modern scientific knowledge, especially in the fields of sciences, mathematics, medicine, astronomy, architecture, legal systems, metallurgy, philology, environmental studies, and aeronautics, etc. To make available online the recitations, chantings, or Ved part of Vedas as practiced in different parts of the country with proper accents and variations. This includes the Prakriti and the Vikriti parthas. Towards the end, I'll try to show you a small film which was made by IGNCA and which won the inscription from UNESCO that the Vedic chanting got as the intangible cultural heritage of India, of humankind. To integrate textual details of Vedic Samhitas, Brahmanas, Aranyakas, Upanishads, Vedangs, etc. available in public domain. To document rare traditions of the Vedas and make them available on the portal. To organize series of lectures by inviting eminent scholars from India and abroad, for creating awareness and propagation of the knowledge systems, knowledge enshrined in the Vedas. A comprehensive list of Vedic learning centers and Vedic scholars for the portal. And to set up a permanent gallery of Vedic implements, showcasing the actual tools or implements that and their use in the Yajna at IGNCA, alongside a virtual version of the same. The portal has a very simple user interface and is aimed at targeting mainly three groups. Those associated with traditional Vedic learning, those curious to know about the Vedas and their contents, and professionals who can relate the Vedas with the modern context. This is how the homepage would look like when you visit the portal. So I can show you, this is the page from the Rig Veda, and here they are given all the mandalas, and here you can select the suktas, and here a video will be played in a window, and here just below it there would be the mool part or the text of the Veda. And on the right hand side, there would be translations that are available to us that have been, we have got the copyright and all. And of course, the commentary of Sayanacharya to make it easily understandable. So on here, we have tried to integrate the oral, the textual, and the audiovisual documentation. Similarly, for the Yajurveda Vajasni Madhyandin Samhita. So here, this is the structure of the Yajurveda. And then again, this the pattern which remains quite the same. This particular person which you are seeing at the screen is one of the greatest exponents of the and treasurer, so to say, of the Vedic traditions. Pandit Parshuram Ghanpatiji, he's no more now. And at the age of 97, we requested him, and he was kind enough to share his wisdom with us. And so this kind of rare recording is also available on the portal. This will give you a glimpse of traditional Vedic schools in India. And as you can see, the whole country is dotted with the many schools which are or gurukulas or pathshalas, Ved pathshalas, and these impart the training to the kids. In brief, if we can enumerate, the portal has been made live on the 9th of August 2017, and this is our portal address. It's vedicheritage.gov.in, and it is being accessed by a large user group. Average monthly hits of the site is over 70 lakhs, and it is expected to grow once we launch it officially. Our initial target was 250 hours, and we have achieved 400 plus hours, and this includes recurated data. This will give you a glimpse that what kind of interest the Vedic studies and the Vedas generate in people all across the world, that we have so many visitors from all over the world. So for the Vedic scholars, the portal offers the recitations of the Samhitas, as I told you, with texts and translations in Hindi by Pandit Satwalikar and in English by H.H. Wilson. Till date, Shakal Samhita of Rig Veda, both in Mandal and Ashtaka Krama, Kandva, Madhyandin, and Taittiriya Samhita of Yajurveda, and select documentations of Samaveda and Atharvaveda have already been made available on the portal. Text and audiovisual material wherever available on Brahmanas, Aranyakas, Upanishads, Vedangas have been made accessible online. For interested users, the introduction along with the basic structure of the Vedas, their significance, etc., have been provided in brief. We have also incorporated illustrated lectures by subject experts on different Vedic themes. A Unicode compliant font named Chobika has been developed by IIT Mumbai for the portal. This includes Vedic notations used in all the four Vedic Samhitas and will be helpful in making the online textual searches easy. Yet another font is being developed. Several seminars, workshops, lectures, and awareness presentations have been organized in order to create the awareness about the topic and the project. Some rare textual and audiovisual data has been received from Gita Press Gorakhpur, Delhi Vedic Trust, Chennai, and Ganpati.com, Chennai, which is integrated as per the metadata structure. Now, what we are looking on is based on the aforementioned achievements, the Vedic Heritage Portal Ministry of Culture, Government of India, and the Trust of IGNCA approved the continuation of the project beyond March 2019 as an internal project of IGNCA with an additional mandate to include content on Itihasa, that is Ramayana and Mahabharata and Puranas, Dharma Shastras, Agamas and Darshanas in phased manner. The pilot, a pilot project on preparation of a graphic novel on Vedic teachings is underway as a part of creating a children's corner on the portal. So we want to be very clear that it is not only, we are not only targeting the elderly people, but also the children. A virtual gallery of Vedic implements is to be created along with detailed information about the usages, etc. of these in the actual Yaga. Work on enhancement of user experience and user interface is also planned. This this is a visual from the Kathopanishad graphic novel on Kathopanishad, where you can see the Nachiketa is standing here and the Vishwajit Yajna is ongoing. So I think this is coming up very nicely. And as I mentioned earlier, a gallery of Vedic implements is to be created along with detailed information about the usages, etc. IGNCA has an impressive collection of about 300 implements that are used in various yagas sourced from Tamil Nadu, Kerala, Andhra, and Karnataka. For example, this is a Drona Kalasha. The material is wood, region is Kerala. And it is followed by descriptions, brief description. Likewise, this is Advaniya. It is a clay pot from Kerala. And what is the function of this particular implement in the Yajna is also given. And lastly, we are also mentioning the text from where we are sourcing this information. Like, for example, this is from Apastamba Shraut Sutra and Katyayan. So feel free to visit us at vedicheritage.gov.in. We are also available on Facebook and we have 2,500 plus followers there. At Twitter, we are available at Vedic IGNCA, where we have 3,000 plus followers. And we will be very happy to receive your comments, suggestions, and feedback at iamvedic.com. @gmail.com. So I think with this, we come to an end of my presentation. It's a very small 9 minutes documentary, but it will give you a lot of idea as to what the Vedic traditions are.
Namaste Rudra Karunamas.
Namaste Rudra Karunamas. Namaste Rudra Karunamas.
Sahasrakshaya Amartya.
Sahasrakshaya Amartya. Sahasrakshaya Amartya.
Purastate Namah Krunama.
Purastate Namah Krunama. Purastate Namah Krunama.
Uttarada Dharaduta.
Uttarada Dharaduta. Uttarada Dharaduta.
Abhivarga Divasparyanta.
Abhivarga Divasparyanta. Abhivarga Divasparyanta.
Antarikshayate Namaha.
Parvatam Vyadra Srujadhara हृदये प्रणानो हायदाये निहो
प्रार्पयतु श्रेष्ठतमाय कर्मणा आप्यायध्वमग्न्या देवेभ्या इन्द्राय भागम् आवस्तेन ईशतमघशगुंसो ध्रुवास्मिन् गोपतौ स्याद् बुक्खीयमानस्य पशून्बाहे अश्मन्नोर्जं पर्वतेज श्रियाणामद्भ्योषधेभ्यो वनस्पतिभ्योऽधिसंवृताम् ृणाश्मगुस्तेक्षुन्मयिता ऊर्जं दुष्मस्तन्ते सुगृच्छतो समुद्रस्य त्वावकयाग्ने परिव्ययामसे पावकोऽस्मभ्यगुं शिवो भव हिमस्य त्वा जरायुणाग्ने परिव्ययामसे पावकोऽस्मभ्यगुं शिवो भव उपज्मन्नुपवेतसेव तरन्नदीश्वा
अग्रे वित्तमपामसि
मण्डूकिताधिरागहे सेमन्नो यज्ञं वा भगवर्णगुं शिवङ्कृधे अपामिदन्यनं समुद्रस्य निवेशनम् अन्यागुस्ते अस्मत्
नत्वा नरहरिदेवं सर्वविघ्नप्रणाशनं पिप्पलादप्रसादाच्च पठाम्याथर्वणिं श्रुतिम् ॐ शरणो देवीरभीष्टय आपो भवन्तु पीतये संयोरभिस्रवन्तु नः आपः प्रणीत भेषजं वरुथं तन्वे मम ज्योक्ष्य सूर्यं दृशे अप्सु मे सोम अब्रवीदन्तरविश्वानि भेषज अग्निं च विश्वसं भुवम् ईशानावर्यानां क्षयन्तेश्चर्षणीनाम् अपोयाचामि भेषजम् अम्बयो यन्त्यध्वभिर्जामयो अध्वरीयता रुञ्चतेर्मधुनापयः आमुर्या उपसूर्ये याभिर्वा सूर्यः सह तानो इन्वन्त्वध्वरम् अपो देवीरुपा ब्रुवे यत्र गावाः पिबन्ति।
ये अग्नयो ये दिवो पृथिव्या समागच्छन्ति शमुद्रमसानाः ते अस्माकं ये द्रव्यं वेष्टा पीता उतिवाय भूत्वा यथा लोकं पुनस्तपये तस्याः
अग्निभ्य इदं नमः
अहर्वे द्वितीयां पूर्णाहुतिं विहोति अग्निभ्य इदं नमः यजमानः अध्वर्यो
अश्वन् अध्वर्यो अश्वन् ददामि
ये अग्नयो ये दिवो पृथिव्या समागच्छन्ति शमुद्रमसानाः ते अस्माकं ये द्रव्यं
This is how a traditional yagyic fire is invoked. And this will give you a glimpse how the Vedas are memorized. This is the Keral tradition. So with this Hari Om, we wish you well, and that's all about from me.
Thank you, Subir, for giving us an overview of the excellent work done by our team in this a very important subject with the help of Ministry of Culture. I'm sure everybody must have enjoyed it, and also it will help in understanding that how this single window access to the Vedic heritage resources is being executed and how it is going to be useful. And your video documentary definitely help in understanding the different dimensions. And I think for even a common person, it will help in knowing more about Vedas traditions. And so I thank you very much. And now,
thank you.
Achal, it's over to you.
Yes, sir. Namaskar. Thank you very much, Professor Gaur. Dr. Sachidanand Joshi ji, Member Secretary IGNCA, Professor Jha, Director CIL, Dr. Gaur, Professor Gaur Kalanidhi HOD, Sudhir Lal ji, my colleague from Vedic Heritage, and our director, Dr. Priyanka Mishra. I'm very, very, very happy to be present here. So, in fact, as Professor Jha and Dr. Sudhir Lalji and Professor Gaur, in their talk, they all told about making our cultural heritage accessible to people. So with that aim only, we are working, and under the like guidance of Professor Jha, Professor Gaur, our member secretary, making our archives accessible to one and all. And he has also taken many bold steps, and the number of exhibitions that have taken place from cultural archives under his tenureship are really, really commendable. Our objects have traveled from India and also abroad while doing this exercise of making things accessible. So now I'll be talking only about the cultural archives. So the cultural archives in Kalanidhi was in fact the guidance, the force behind the start of cultural archives in IGNCA was Dr. Kapila Vatsayan. So under her guidance, IGNCA was able to collect materials. It was her vision that IGNCA acquired the collections, which other organizations in the country were not focusing on. I'll just give you the glimpse of the cultural archives, the collection of typology. We have personal collections. Then we have got collections which have been acquired. I'll come in detail on that. And then there are documentation by IGNCA of the programs that we have done, of the interviews that we have done in our media center and all. So that has also become part of our archives. And the broad division of our archives is, we have objects, books, documents related to Sahitya. We have objects, books, documents, slides related to architecture. We call it at Vastu Shilp. Then we have Chhaya Shilp, in which we have photographs of renowned photographers like Raja Deendayal, Henri Cartier-Bresson, Sunil Jana, and more. We have documentation of music, was another visual collection, and we have ethnographic collection. In fact, one of the finest ethnographic collections in the world is present in the cultural archives of the IGNCA. And this is more from the point of view of housing storage, that we have done the classification in terms of 2D objects like paintings, 3D objects, sculptures, textiles, masks, puppets, which will require like a special furniture for them, gramophone records and audiovisual materials, where the fragility of the objects make them will require a specialized and climate control systems. And then all the collections have got separate accession registers. Aims and objectives of present initiative of digitization, in fact, they have already been mentioned by Professor Jha and all. It is to make the collection accessible to people, to masses, to scholars, to public. So this is the broad collection of, you can see, in literature we have got R.C. Ranga collection, and all this information is available on our website if you are interested in seeing it. For example, when we say other collections, we have got Brunner's painting collection, Anand Kumar Swami collection, Purga collection. So there is no single collection which is less important or more important. Every collection in cultural archives is really important and is a treat for scholars, for public also, because it evokes interest in art and culture. And there are a lot of people, a lot of students who have come to IGNCA as simple visitors, but then they plunged into this art world and are still continuing into it. So that is the aim, and that is the beauty of the culture, the archives of the IGNCA. Now I start with it that this is like a representative collection of the IGNCA, Raja Deendayal, renowned photographer of 20th century, Henri Cartier-Bresson, French photographer known all over the world, Shambhusha, Sunil Jana. So Raja Deendayal, if you are interested, you can see the information. And we have the number of objects that Raja Deendayal collection has. It has got glass plate negative, which is the majority, which you can see from this pie chart, is the majority of the collection is Raja Deendayal collection. Around 3,000 glass plate negatives are we have. And from the point of view of storage, that is the most difficult part. Then we have got photo prints. We have got studio equipment, which was used by Raja Deendayal himself. We have furniture pieces, which were part of the Raja Deendayal studio. We have microfilms of studio photography. We have, then he had also, his family members had also done exhibitions of Deendayal's work that were also acquired by IGNCA when we collected the entire collection of Raja Deendayal. So that is the vision, that is the foresight of IGNCA's founders, that this collection was acquired. Otherwise, such collections are normally either out of the country or in the hands of private collectors and are not available for public. These are some of the photographs of Maharaja. This is Tata. I'm not, in fact, talking more about the photographer and the photographs he has done. I will be talking more about the information that will be useful for audience in making IGNCA accessible to them and information that they require to visit IGNCA and look at these objects on their own eyes. This is the camera which Raja Deendayal used. Then we have Henri Cartier-Bresson collection. Some of the photographs of Henri Cartier-Bresson. This is the funeral of, if not after funeral, we heard in Jabalpur we saw the footage of immersion of ashes of Mahatma Gandhiji, which are in our cultural audiovisual archives. And so this is what was going on. So you can see a beautiful photograph by Henri Cartier-Bresson. Then we have Sunil Jana collection from the tribal regions. Shambhusha collection, a rare photograph where Tagore is watching the performance in Shantiniketan. Then we have Elizabeth Bruner collection. You can see the collection that we have. Anand Kumar Swami collection. Again, I'm telling you the collection that IGNCA acquired over a period of time is one of its kind. You don't find such collection very easily elsewhere. So it's really a pilgrimage. Cultural Archives is a pilgrimage for scholars if they are interested in learning about it, about these collections, or they want to do research on it, or otherwise also a general public if they want to see in the collection. It is open for all, but with some conditions that you have to take an appointment before coming. And then we have sculptures from Kumar Swami collection that you can see. And now I will talk about the problems that storages they face all over the world. So even IGNCA also faced these problems, but over a period of time we have been able to to manage our collections very well, and now the problems are less, but there is always a scope of improvement from the point of view of furniture or the material, because material every day there is a research and new material comes which should be used for the thing. So scope of improvement will always remain, and the job of an archivist is always an ongoing thing. It doesn't stop. That doesn't mean that if you have archived your digitally archived your collection, then that's the end. It continues. It takes a lot of care. It's like, it's more difficult than taking care of a child, taking care of an archives. And IGNCA is lucky to have a very, very competent department with great mentors who have always been helping us in doing good work of preservation of these valuable articles. So in fact, if you see, the problem of storages is all over the world. In fact, 60% of the museums in the world, I'm not talking of India, of the world, have problems in storage. So that was the survey which was done by ICROM, and then they had launched in 2011 a methodology of archiving. And during this methodology, a criteria of professional storage was made. And these criteria are very, a person is in charge, administrative document exists, the building is sound, existence of a storage department with at least three sectors. One is accession, storage, and expedition. Expedition is movement of the objects. Storage contains only objects, accessions, or to be accessions objects. No object is on the floor. Each object has a personal space. All objects are accessioned, and accession objects can be found in less than 3 minutes. Because if you are able to do all these, then only you will be able to reach an object. One has to move to remove no more than one other object. All objects are sound, clean, and ready for research or exhibition. So if you are following these criteria, you see, we are not talking anywhere here about controlling the climate. We are not talking of anything else, because once you have done this, all these what criteria of a professional storage are fulfilled, then you can do anything with the collection. Then you can conserve it nicely. You can launch a preventive conservation plan. You can make exhibitions like in a click of time, without any wasting any time. You don't have to see the collection. Everything is in fact. You can do a very good documentation once your objects are kept according to this criteria. If your objects are cluttered and all, you will never be finishing your documentation, and there will be a very good chance that your objects will deteriorate and they may be stolen, and you will not even come to know that object has been stolen. These type of problems are occurring every day all over the world. India is not an exception. It is not about developed country or a developing country. It is about a developed museum or a developed art center. So we are going, we have already in IGNCA, we have tried to make our storage a developed archives. And it has been, when people they visit from abroad, they are very happy. It is almost the same thing that they see in a big museum like Louvre and all. But I can always say that your building can be a five-star building or a building with having marbles from Makrana. But if you have not done these criteria of a professional storage, then it is of no use. Your storage is of really no use. It will be very good. Good office, or it will be a very nice place where you can have nice chats and all, but it's not a nice storage. So now I'll take you to the packaging and shifting of the IGNCA that we had done. We were able to do it nicely because our objects were organized properly. So it was not like we were not reinventing the wheel. We had a storage like this. And then for initial preparation was that every object, according to its needs, according to its fragility, it had to be packed. So we made customized boxes for our collection and dismantling of storage. You can see a packing, taping, use of cushioning material for very, very fragile objects, covering textiles, rolled textiles with Tyvek, non-woven textile. You see this? You see the amount of work, the amount of care that goes into to a packing. Then transportation. And this is how we left our IGNCA when we moved lock, stock, and barrel. And then installation at new location. Already we are installed, we are functional. Then the laboratory is functional. The objects are already well kept, nicely done. They're ready for exhibition, they're ready for research. The puppets, lunar collection, and conservation is also going on simultaneously of the collection. And these are the types of boxes that we use during packing. You see, these are all empty boxes which have come out of the thing. So we used wooden boxes, we used iron trunks, even we recycled a lot of things. It was all based on the, you see, for keeping photograph nicely, we had these felt covered boxes. And all this was possible, thank you, by these people of 26 professionals working at the IGNCA Kalanidhi C division. And we definitely had the blessings of our member secretary, our director Kalanidhi, Professor Ramesh Gaur. But these people, they played a commendable role. It was more than 20,000 of man hours spending in 6 months' time that we were able to do it. Thanking you. Thank you.
Thank you, HL, for wonderful work. Congratulations to you and the entire team. So thank you very much. Now our member secretary has also joined. So I would like to, without taking more time now, first I would like to invite him for his concluding remarks on today's program and also about agency.
Very good evening to you, Professor Ramesh Gaur, Professor Jha, Dr. Achal Pandya, Dr. Sudhir Lal, and all distinguished participants on this panel who have joined this presentation. We have tried to give you only a glimpse of what we are doing at the IGNCA. May it be the Cultural Informatics Archive, may it be Vedic Heritage Portal, or may it be the Cultural Archives of IGNCA. And as you can understand, it is a uphill task to maintain and manage all these things. But with the great efforts of all my colleagues, Professor Jha, Dr. Achal Pandya, Dr. Sudhir Lal, Dr. Gaur, we could actually manage to do the things well in time with proper care and due diligence. Archiving is an important thing, and I know that if we are having proud on our cultural heritage, if we say that our legacy, our cultural lineage is great, actually the onus is on us to maintain a proper archive and museum so that in next generations, people should think about the efforts which we have done in maintaining these archives. Unfortunately, only yesterday also I have told in this deliberation that there are very few people who really understand about the basic nuances of archive. There are very few people in the society who can really understand the definition of archive, leave apart their in-depth understanding related to archive. But this during this archive, International Archives Week, we should also try to expand. We should try to spread the knowledge about archiving, what kind of pains one has to take in managing these things, in archiving these things, has to be told to the people by and large. Because everybody is very cautious about referring to the lineage, referring to the heritage, referring to the cultural wealth which we have. But how many of us are really taking precautions in doing that? In fact, you would appreciate that people are not even careful about keeping the books in a proper shape. We all see the conditions of books in the public library, and we see people damaging those books for their own benefit, and just to be a little lazy on their part in either getting it photocopied or getting it scanned. And we have seen that people even dare to tear apart the book using the blades and taking out the papers which they want. It is the pathetic situation. It shows the psyche of people who want to sort of preserve the knowledge. Similar cases with the archiving, that unless a thing is properly documented, unless a thing is properly digitized, unless a thing is properly noted down with its reference and history, there is no meaning of keeping the thing in the archive. So it's not only just keeping the thing in a preserved manner, it is also important to have the detailed documentation of that. IGNCA as an institution is trying to teach the methodology through which we can develop this science in India. Unfortunately, in India, we are not aware of all these things, and we don't take care. It's not in our priority. That is unfortunate thing, that proper archiving, managing the museums, managing the repository is not in our priority. We don't even think about these things, and we don't even care about these things. People often forget that that we need to have efficient manpower, dedicated persons working in this field. We need to have more and more bright youngsters to join these fields. We on one hand are trying to preserve our rich cultural heritage, trying to conserve all these things in whatever manner we can and in the proper shape. But also at the same time, we are also trying to disseminate all these things for the wider circulation. That is why we have started schemes like National Cultural Audiovisual Archives, about which Professor Jha has given a remarkable presentation. And you could understand how we have not only matched the target, but we have done much more than the expected and desired target, just to show that if you have strong willpower, you can really do magics with this. We always feel blessed that we have rich Vedic heritage, rich Vedic tradition in our country. But how many of us really know anything beyond beyond the fact that we have four Vedas, Rigved, Yajurved, Atharved, Samved? There are, you can count on your fingers that people would know something beyond these four Vedas and the basic nuances of Brahmans and Aranyaks and Upanishads and Puranas. So we need to understand about the rich Vedic knowledge which our country has, our ancestors have developed. We all know that we had a great Shruti and Smriti parampara, but now today, when we have access to all sorts of technological advancement in our country, in the globe, we should also make best use of this to cater the preservation of this knowledge. Professor Achal Pandya has also given you a remarkable presentation related to cultural archives, he has also tried to give you an insight about the process through which we have shifted our articles from one place to another carefully, with proper attention, care, and placing them at place. So today, if you come to IGNCA at Hotel Janpath, you would see that how we have tried to sort of make use of this space without creating much fuss about the space, creating much fuss about the process of shifting, creating much fuss about the constraints which we are facing. So this is the best part, and this shows that the adaptability is the best part. and the accommodation which we have learned from our ancestors, that how best use you can make of the situation, that is what we are trying to do. In fact, we would be interested to sort of develop training programs and courses, short-term workshops for the benefit of others. I could see more than 130 participants joining this webinar, and I'm sure there are many who are related to the same profession, and we would definitely try to organize some workshops for your benefit. How to make best use of your space available? We have done some very good workshops with international agencies of making the best use of your storage spaces. Not only that, how with minimum efforts and how with minimum infrastructure we can recreate the entire thing in a more beautiful manner, in a more befitting manner. Those things we have to learn, those things we must understand, how to make best use of the information technology for the benefit of the dissemination of knowledge as far as the cultural heritage is concerned. So at this center, we all are trying to achieve all these things through our efforts and through our exposure to various fields of knowledge. I'm really happy that the Professor Gaur thought about this seminar, because often we invite people from other institutions and request them to deliver lecture, but we have so much to tell about ourselves which we never tell because of our modesty. But now I think that it is not becoming vocal, but it is becoming at least accessible to the fact that most people should understand and know about what all IGNCA is doing and what is our capacity to do the things. So that we all are here, we are doing this job, we have a bright young team, dedicated team of scholars, administrators. I see our director has also joined, Dr. Priyanka Mishra. She is director of administration. So we have a bright, dedicated team to take care of our rich cultural heritage and our rich cultural traditions. We definitely need more and more bright young scholars to join IGNCA. The more you come to closer to us, the more you understand about us, the more you learn about us. I think that would be a wonderful tribute to the entire field of cultural heritage. So with these words, I think I must congratulate Dr. Gaur and his entire team. And I must thank Professor Jha, Dr. Sudhir Lal, Dr. Achal Pandya, Dr. Priyanka Mishra for making this evening a memorable one. I hope that all the participants must have enjoyed the deliberations of this evening. Thank you very much. Namaskar.
Thank you, sir. Under your dynamic leadership, last 5 years, IGNCA has become more vibrant and more visible, more active. And we all are with you. And I know many more milestones to be achieved. And I'm sure once we all settle down in new, I think somebody was asking a question that, have you shifted to a new building? Yes, we have shifted to old Janpath Hotel as a new location for IGNCA, and we will be very much some part of our things are already accessible, some are in process, and we'll be soon making everything accessible, including our microfilm collection, our print library. We are also having to have good facilities for readers, and soon we will announce that. So now, Priyankaji, thank you very much for joining, and I'm sure you have gone some idea about current programs and activities.
Thank you so much.
So now next program, once we settle down, let's have a bigger program and give more glimpses about our new facilities and new resources, and tell people that yes, we are going to be functional very soon. And I think that will be, Ajal, that will also be a record, that in such a record time, we shifted such a huge, I think that going to be a very huge case study for the world, people in the field of archive and other things, that how such a large amount of almost It, as per my estimate, even Kalanidhi alone have more than 8 lakh resources. And moving those in such a record time and in such a perfect professional manner, it itself is a many people may like to learn from these experiences. And you rightly presented that particular stories and shifting issues. And also, I can tell you, like, the way you highlighted the cultural archive collection, it's not just for India. When I was in Iran and I went to Golestan Palace, I think they have such a wonderful album of Raja Deen Dayal, which we don't have in our collection. So that we thought of having some kind of linkages. Like I discussed with them, you give exchange, we will exchange something with you. You give some images in digital to us, we will give you some images. So your collection will also increase. Our collection will also increase. So there are many things to go. And I think now, thank you very much. Bye-bye. Thank you all participants.